Well, once again, here at Contenders, very excited right now because we have an Academy Award winner and many other awards. Russell Crowe, welcome to Contenders, Russell.
She's Pete. How are you?
Very good, very good. Welcome from Australia, I believe, today we're talking to you.
I'm in the bush in a little town called Nana Glen.
Wow. Well, the project we're talking about here is an extraordinary one that aired on Showtime, The Loudest Voice. This is a series, limited series that you did and played Roger Ailes. And before we get into talking about it, I just want to show people a bit of this. And first of all, it's an incredible transformation physically that you did too. But the whole story here and how you approached it is fascinating. So let's take a look at Russell Crowe in The Loudest Voice.
Listen to me, Joe. There's a whole world of people out there who don't know what to believe. They're so twisted up by the liberal media, they don't even know who the good guys are anymore. Now, you tell those people what to think, you've lost them. But if you tell them how to feel, they're yours. I started this network with nothing. Everybody just going around saying Roger Ailes, he's not a news guy. Roger Ailes is gonna fail. Just laughing at me. Take a good look around this room. These people, they keep us on the air. They're laughing all the way to the bank.
But journalism
is history. Yes, son. And history gets written by the winners. We are winning.
Oh, I have to say, I mean, when you look at you as Roger Ailes, I can't imagine how many hours a day you had to go through that transformation, but with the prosthetics and things, is this the most challenging in terms of that, just in terms of the transformation that you've done in your career?
Well, I have played around with it quite a bit, going back all the way to the middle of the 90s and things like Virtuosity, where I had glass coming out of my neck and stuff like that, But you generally tend to not be doing something as large as this for as long as this. I think at the end of the day, it was 68 applications or something like that in that range. And the very first one, the testing phase was 6.5 hours, and stuff like that. So, but that was a choice right from the beginning. I mean, Roger had a particular look. And if you're going to pretend to be Roger, you got to step into that, and just go with it. I actually just noticed I'm wearing Roger's watch. I've got one watch with me in the bush, and it just happens to be this is Roger Allen's watch in the show. And I dropped hints on like a weekly basis about, geez, it would be nice to take this one, with me at the end. And then the producer very kindly gifted it to me. I mean, it was a really rough job. If you're going to do what came down to a 2.5 hour, 3 hour makeup of a morning like that, and it's not the sort of thing you can completely zone out with, because you have to be active in order to make it easy for the makeup people. I've seen a lot of actors when they're working in full prosthetics, they don't realize the advantage they have, And I've seen them try to push through the prosthetic, but that's not what you do. Live inside it, I remember making that decision. We're doing going to do prosthetics from day one, and the part of your brain, the sensible part of your brain, goes, "Fuck off, man. Are you serious?"
It's so interesting too, and I know the producer of the show said he had one person in mind, never thought that you would ever say yes. You don't do television much, or I haven't seen you do it in, many years. So he didn't think maybe you'd say yes. Why did you say yes? Why did this opportunity to play Roger Ailes, which a lot of people have opinions of in different ways, so you're walking into something like that, but you have to find a way into him in ways that people don't know and show us a person, a three-dimensional person that we may not know. Why did you want to do that in this case?
Well, when Jason Blum reached out first, my initial answer was just simply, I'm just not interested in that, you know. And he was sort of persistent, and he sent a script that was excellent, you know. It was just really compelling, and it was really honest about Roger, and it gave the opportunity to actually play the human being and not play the stereotype that he had, unfortunately, through the course of his career and what happened at the end of his career, he'd sort of like become. Look, man, I knew it was going to be a challenge, but you don't get asked to do that sort of challenge that often. You know what I mean? There's not 20 people waiting outside the door with something truly so scary as a prospect that you know it's going to keep you up at night. That doesn't happen all the time, you know? So when it does come around, you've got to be honest to your sort of why you do the job. And as much as I knew it was going to physically really hurt me and it was going to be problematic right from the beginning, and I was also going on faith and didn't know how the second half of the story was going to be treated. At a certain point, you know, I start to talk to people who knew him. And, you know, some people who I've known for a long time who I didn't realize had a connection, you know. I have one guy who I've known for ages, man, you know, and I never realized that he was, but he had such an intimate relationship with Roger that Roger represented him for nearly 20 years, you know, basically as a manager, you know. So, I got to learn a lot. And, you know, there's lots of, you know, stories about losing his temper or having a particular perspective on something, you know. But as he was coming up through the business, as he was becoming the person Roger Ailes, he wasn't always the Roger Ailes that, you know, in the Obama era Fox reporting, for example. He wasn't always that guy, you know. Right. He came from other places. One of the most interesting things that I learned about him was that at one point in time he'd been a Broadway producer. And, you know, earlier in his life, when he was in college years and stuff like that, you know, he was the guy at the piano leading the sing-along. And he was a very, you know, had a very theatrical sort of background, you know. And I just found that to be quite fascinating as one of many of the various building blocks that made up who Roger is. But, you know, certainly there was a risk element in playing a character who'd been so strongly and roundly vilified. But, you know, I'm perverse in that way. I mean, that kind of made it a little bit more attractive because it's more, you know, because you go into, it's like, it's fine playing somebody who's everybody's hero, whatever, you know, but some trying to find the humanity in somebody who did and said this collection of things, and you know that because it's on a record and it's fucking real, and you're sitting there looking at it going, some of this makes me physically ill, but that's the gig, you know what I mean? You're not always going to play simple and easy characters, you know, and quite frankly, when it comes down to it, to make my day more interesting, to, you know, the more complex, the better, you know? The funny thing, you read so many stories about Roger and people, you know, having a negative response to him, and obviously he did some very bad things. But on the other side of that, if you talk to the people who we worked with for a long period of time, their fondness for him, and particularly that in that circle of being with him, you felt like you were getting something done. You felt like you're achieving something, you know. So, you know, he had a lot of different points that had to be emphasize without, of course, going away from the reality of the story.
The reality of where it went to. And of course, what he built there at Fox News, what he saw, you know, as an opportunity and went in and did, he probably, and now in retrospect, doesn't get the level of credit for that. But you look at the effect of what he's done, whatever you think of it. I just, before we have to go, I have to ask you how you internalize. How do you get in to a point where you have to separate everything and you have to find a way to almost like this person or to be this person inside, to understand them, to be able to play them.
That's a sort of a British theater thing where, you know, where you have to like the character or love the character, you know, in order to play him. But I've never prescribed to that myself, because I think with love comes forgiveness or something, you know what I mean? So you can miss some edges, you know. But what I do, you know, love is the job, and the job of discovery and all that sort of stuff. You know, I could give you lots of flowery ways of describing how to internalize a guy like Roger, but really, man, it's like you got to block your nose and learn your lines. You know? It's like you fundamentally have too much to do in this situation where, you know, we work X amount of time. I would give myself sort of Saturday as a bit of a free day, and then my Sundays were all about preparing and revising for the week ahead. And because you're dealing with 20 to 24 pages of dialogue every week, you're dealing with every week multiple large speeches, because that was his thing. You know, he would talk to the newsroom, he would talk about, you know, he had fucking opinions and he would freely give them, you know. So yeah, I can't really give you too much detail, and you know, over and above the simple job of that stack of work that you're facing every week, where you're, you know, doing those speeches, leading plot lines and what have you, you know, that in and of itself was such, you know, that you're spending hours and hours every week thinking about it. So just in the process of learning what you have to do, you get that level of contemplation, you know. That was a hell of a job. That job. Fucking good day, Pete.
Well, a hell of a job is a good way to describe what you did in this. Already has won you a Golden Globe and nominations for SAG and Critics' Choice and on and on. And it's definitely worth checking out if you haven't seen The Loudest Voice yet, the whole series. And thank you for joining us today on Contenders, Russell.
Cheers, Peter.